a lot for the intro.
I guess that this already solves part of my expertise. Yeah, we will talk about mobile augmented reality, and actually more specifically about the relation between this and the computer vision, and how we can use computer vision to actually have a better AR product. And I will show in the end a case study, which is something that most of you are familiar with, which is the POI process. So I have to warn you that this will be a technical expose, so I have to excuse myself for the people that are not engineering. There will be ugly numbers in it. So, all right, so as the first question you heard, the question, the augmented reality needs a definition, and you may be tempted to start to define augmented reality by asking yourself what reality is. I don't advise this, because as soon as you do this, you get into a place which is crowded with philosophers and physicists and so on, and they make things very, very complicated. So instead of going to the reality definition, I will just stick to a very engineering approach. And basically, augmented reality is superimposing artificial generated sensorial stimuli over the real ones. Now, obviously, not any kind of such superposition is an augmented reality. What differentiates one to the true augmented reality is basically that this is coordinate. So what we need is that the extra part acts coherently with respect to the changes that happen in the world on one side and the observer on the other side. And the key point is, what are these relevant changes? What does mean relevant? And we will see what does mean relevant with respect to different applications. So the question we try to answer is whether we have currently the technology that is able to provide a basis for our range of AR applications. So we have different AR applications, and they will trigger different technological requirements. It depends really on what you're trying to do. If you take, for example, the identification of points of interest, as opposed to navigation or to general object of interest browsing, each of them will induce a different quality metric that will qualify the performance of the application. In the POI identification, which it's a very popular case, the quality metric is basically defined to whether I can actually recognize a point of interest or not. Can I confuse it with something else? And basically, depending on this, I can quantify whether a solution is good or not. That's completely different from navigation, for example, where if I want the augmented reality system to show me where my car has to go, then I don't deal with a discrete error, I deal with a continuous error. And then you can have what means a good system with, let's say, an accuracy of a few meters, as opposed to something that gives you an excess of say 10 meters, which is pretty much unusual. So now, inside the same application, you can have different goals. And again, different goals will lead to different requirements. It's one thing if you want to know whether where is the Carpathian Mountains, case in which you really don't need much in terms of accuracy. It's a different thing if you want to resolve the buildings in a city, or if you want to resolve people in a crowd. If you want to identify people in the crowd, you will need an accuracy that is in the order of meters, maybe centimeters. This in turn means that you need to have certain requirements about the accuracy that is driven to the estimation of the position of the observer and the orientation of the observer. By position I mean here the Cartesian position, and by orientation I mean the angular position. So you see that in the typical case of the buildings, the POIs, the buildings in the city, you will need an accuracy that is in the order of a few meters, and an orientation that is in the order of a few degrees. Now, if you look at what happens currently into the mobile phones, in principle, we do have everything that we need to actually accomplish the task. We do have a GPS that provides us with the position, provides us with the X, the Y, and the altitude. We do have magnetometers, and we do have accelerometers. Together, those are able to provide us with the orientation. That's the good part. The bad part is they don't work very well. The GPS easily exceeds tens of meters in accuracy. The magnetometer currently, you can bet on things like 10 degrees, 15 degrees. It really depends on how you calibrate it. It really depends on where you are and so on. So now, in general, into this area of data processing from sensors, things are not so bad as long as you have redundancy. If you do have redundancy, so if you do have sensors that actually are able to provide overlapping information, then the whole research community has developed reliable solutions, reliable algorithms to extract the true signal inside the corrupted versions. However, what we are dealing with is a very low redundancy of information. We have only the GPS that provides the location, and we have only the combination of magnetometer and accelerometers to provide orientation. And statistically speaking, those things are not well behaved, which makes things pretty difficult from the point of view of filtering such errors. So, what can we do? Well, we can approach the thing two ways, of course. One obvious step is, well, if there is no redundancy, and that's what is needed, then we need to produce new information. The other approach, which will have a much lower margin, is to assume that you can do best or better with what is available. The later one will probably not be enough to make significant steps, because things are already fairly well developed in that side. So how can you increase redundancy of information? Well, one thing that you can do is to exploit the camera. Camera is something like a super sensor. If you think about the accelerometer and magnetometer, each of them offers you three numbers. The GPS offers you 10 numbers or whatever in accuracies and altitude and so on. In total, that's about 20 dimensions they offer. A camera sensor even a very small one, offers you hundreds of thousands of measurements. So the richness of the information is many order of magnitudes different in the favor of the camera. And we do know for sure that humans are actually able to also extract pretty much of the information intake out of the visual system alone. So that means that we do have reasons to believe that this is possible. So what you can do with all this information is really an interesting question. Of course, there are other ways to increase redundancy. The immediate one is actually adding sensors. So, and this is something that actually happens, right? You have gyroscopes currently added in the mobile phones. You do have new global position systems that are in preparation in Europe that will very likely offer you a much better accuracy. Another thing that is relatively undiscussed is that you can actually rely on the user interaction to provide additional information. This is a topic that in the area of image retrieval is very well studied. So the feedback of the user, it's an important source of information. So we will talk mostly about the sensor camera. So there is an area in computer science which is called computer vision, which bothers itself to trying to obtain image understanding. Now, image understanding is the holy grail of this area, and that would be very useful for augmented reality. As soon as you do have image understanding, then you can say what the objects are that the camera sees, and you can say what is the position of objects, and a lot of other things. Well, that's the goal, and that's a lot of things that are going on under this computer vision topic, with multiple sub areas. But all in all, the main goal is really still quite far from being reached. So if we look at what we have in terms of tasks that we would like to have in the mobile augmented reality, and what are the topics from the computer vision that are mapping to those, we do see that there are quite a few of them. You have sensor fusion that deals with how to best combine the information from different kind of sources. You have optical flow that deals with analyzing the motion of the things in the image. You have visual signatures that allow you to compare the appearance of objects together with the similarity measurements. You have model estimations that try to solve problems like what is the positions of objects, or the shape of the object, and so on. Finally, you have classification problems, where basically you are trying to solve the problem of object identification. So on the lower part you have the tasks, and the tasks are in, let's say, in the order of complexity. The ego motion is actually concerned itself with only saying how is the camera actually moving with respect to the world and what is the position of it. Now, the object detection and tracking is it's significantly more complex. It tries to establish over the time the variation of the position of individual objects that are visible. And finally, object identification, as the name suggests, it's going to be useful to establish, for example, whether two images are of the same person and so on. So, what are we going to expect out of the computer vision? I would like to give first the bad news is that generally speaking, the task of image understanding is pretty much failed. It has proved that the gaps between the sensorial, so what we actually capture, namely the pixels, and the meaning of that is depicted by the pictures, it's simply too large. Why is it so large? I will show you a contrived example. If you look at this picture, some of you may see a young lady, some of you may see an old lady. If I modify slightly the pictures, this is a bit more obvious that on the left side you have the young lady and on the right side you have the old lady. But the problem is that sensorially speaking, this is an identical image. Nevertheless, for a human, it can have semantic diversity. And this is actually extremely difficult to replicate in a system which would need to actually take into account for being able to perform such tasks a lot of information that is completely outside the context of the computer vision. The reciprocal is true also. You do have a very high sensorial diversity in these two images, which look extremely unlikely. But nevertheless, semantically, everybody is able to recognize that we are dealing with chairs. So, again, the problem here with the computer vision is it is very difficult to capture all the cultural and non-visual context that actually drives the process of classification in humans. Well, that once we are done with the bad news, now the good news is that in very specific narrow domains, we do have met with significant success in image understanding. How this is possible is by the fact that you are injecting prior information that represents the particular domain knowledge. And as soon as you are able to do this, then the semantic gap can be covered successfully. So you do have success stories that everyone knows by now, like the face detections and iris recognition and optical character recognition and so on. The examples abound also in terms of medical areas and so on. So, what can we expect out of the computer vision? Well, this is no silver bullet. Instead of an end-all solution that will solve all our problems, we will most likely see a landscape where AR technologies are very problem specific. Such a problem specific topic is the PUI browsing. Now, PUI browsing is actually the clearly the primary application in AR. You have a few companies already that have solutions for this. Everybody knows LiDAR, everybody knows Youtube. There are probably at least 10 applications that are able to provide this. And it should be fun, and it should be easy to use. I mean, what you should get out of this is something that is much more usable than the conventional way of using, for example, a map. However, what you actually get, it's a lot of usability issues with the current current product. You have an unreliable accuracy that comes from the problems of sensors that we actually discussed before. And this is very annoying. It's not the inaccuracy, it's the fact that it's very unreliable. So as soon as you, you cannot rely on the accuracy, you cannot make any assumptions of what your experience in the end will be. Another problem is these applications are fully making use of all the sensors available. The camera is on, the GPS is on, everything is on, the Wi-Fi is on, and that leads to an extremely large power consumption. Typically, an AR application will take between 80 to 100% of the computer load, of the CPU load, and it is very likely to completely drain your battery in things like an hour or two. Another usability issue is that it imposes awkward usage patterns. Everybody knows the funny gesture of calibrating the compass, which some disgruntled user actually commented to be a demanded octopus move. Also, if you take any kind of application, the problem of latency in the compass actually forces you to have stop and go motions while you're keeping the device always at the eye level so that you can interact with the application. This kind of thing also implies that the visualization is difficult. If you go with such an application outside in bright sun, the visibility of the information is dramatically reduced. So what you can do as an application developer is to try to counteract with having large text, large graphical elements, which in the end clutter a lot the actual surface of the display. So you get a lot less reality and a lot more overlays. So what we can do in terms of bringing computer vision on it? Well, with image tracking, you can actually provide estimations of the pose changes. The advantages are that you can obtain a good accuracy. It is fully autonomous, and which means you do not have to be connected with any kind of architecture that is outside your device. It has a disadvantage. It does not provide you an absolute estimation. It just tells you, like a more or less like a gyroscope, what happens when you move your device. Now, image recognition is something that actually can bring you pose estimation. The absolute pose estimation, of course, it's a major benefit. The downside is that such a image recognition process requires an infrastructure, which means a sort of cloud computing. It requires visibility. You cannot recognize something that actually is not on your line of sight. If you are, for example, in a place where your vision is blocked and you are actually trying to see a landmark that is behind, then of course that helps you in no way. Ultimately, the reliability of such processes, by definition, something that will be uneven because of the statistical significance of the landmarks. Some landmarks will gather more traction, and you will be able to build better models for them, while others, which are less interesting, will get a lot less visibility. Finally, image registration, together with image stitching, which is known into panorama of building, something that you all know from the street map, for example, it's something that can provide an useful usage pattern by alternating the online with the offline. The advantages are that this is battery friendly. As soon as you are offline, then you can simply switch off most of the sensors. It is visualization friendly because this does not force you to anymore interact with the device in a predefined manner, where your pose is really restricted. And finally, it offers the possibility to extend the user interaction. For example, it allows the possibility to actually provide pose corrections by the user, with the benefit for the user to get information on a higher level of detail. So, what we try to do is to build such a system, and the requirements for such a system are that the computational load must be extremely reduced due to multiple reasons. First of all, the platforms are there is a diversity of platforms. Not all of them are featuring gigahertz processors, and even if they do, nevertheless, any kind of processor load implies power consumption. You also need to be able to deal robustly with all the difficult conditions that appear in real-life scenarios, like low light, clutter motion, and blur, and so on. And finally, of course, you need to be able to ensure a good accuracy of the system. So, I will just show you an example, which is actually done yesterday, of an application that that actually implements such a strategy. This is your typical usage scenario, and here it's a new usage scenario that is proposed. So as soon as you turn around and you make a sweep motion on the vicinity, the system instantly builds a panoramic view of the surroundings and switches offline, which means that at this point all the highly consumption equipment is off. Furthermore, by preserving the same panorama, you can change the surfing criteria and look for things that for different things, which means in turn that you can actually conserve and better use the display space. Finally, you will see that the tracking stability of the landmarks that are displayed is greatly improved by the presence of the image tracker, which helps in the process of reading, actually, and in the process of identification altogether.
Sorry, if you want to set up, we'll take a few questions. Incidentally, anyone who's got an iPhone, there are two essential applications you need if you want to play around with image tracking or with image recognition. One of them is called Omobi. And Omobi is a great application that allows you to take a picture of just about anything. So a shoe, a chair, a pair of glasses, a handbag, even something like a wristwatch. And it will identify it for you. So it goes off and looks it up in the database. In some cases, it's actually pretty good. You can take a picture of a watch, and it'll tell you that it's not just a watch, but it also identifies the company that makes it. So that's a Rolex or a Citizen or whatever it is. And of course, you know, with these applications, there's the obligatory. This is where you can buy it on Google. But it's still a good application nevertheless. And if you have I think iPhone and Android, there's one called Google Goggles. Google Goggles is another really cool application that does image recognition. You can take pictures of famous works of art. So you can be walking around the Louvre, take a picture of the Mona Lisa, and it'll identify that picture for you. Or you can do pictures of landmarks. So if you stand in front of, Nelson's Column in London, for example, you can take a picture and it'll visually identify that for you. And of course, it does things like wine, books, and other products which you can buy on Google as well. So as you're here, do we have any questions for no questions? I have a question for you. In the example you gave, you spoke very much around using location-based services to find out what's around you. which is great, but as you say, camera accuracy is not that fantastic. So just standing there, you know, looking at a famous landmark, the bubble telling you that that's Leicester Square is over here somewhere, so it's not that useful. Do you think that that'll start getting replaced with recognition of all buildings? So do you think Google will be uploading all the contents from Street View, for example, into a database that they'll make available?
Yeah, well, I mean, this is a goal that is it's definitely difficult to achieve. The problem is Google has, of course, the Street View, which gives you a nice image of all the landmarks. However, this image is acquired in very particular conditions, right? It's acquired in full summer with the sun shining and so on. This is very different from what is the typical case when you will go to the pub. When you go to the pub, it will be dark outside. And there will be a completely different aspect of the street where you are to what the database consists of. So the only way to cope with this is to actually get more relevant examples of such a landmark under very different conditions. So you can get a street view for night and so on. And this crowdsourcing is, of course, a potential way to go. However, as I mentioned, this will work work well for particular landmarks that are very famous, right? Where a lot of people will actually go and take pictures, and then you can build your models about it. It will not work with your favorite pub from the village, because there the number of people that will actually provide data about will be small, and hence also the models that you can statistically build will be much less reliable. So I think that we will see this. It will not be a full solution.
Excellent. Thank you very much.